Please be seated for those of you who are actually here. And on behalf of Jake and Amy and their families, to all of you watching online, it's my privilege to welcome you and to this wedding celebration. Obviously, things are a little bit different in that there's about 12 people here right now, and who knows how many watching online. But what is not different today is the purpose of our celebration. We've come together today, online and in person, in the presence of God, to unite this man and this woman in holy matrimony. Marriage is a wonderful and mysterious union, and it is given to us by God for our good. For Jake and Amy, marriage is not simply the natural progression of a relationship of love and affection, but it is also a union founded on their shared Christian faith. As their pastor and friend, it is my joy to be able to perform this ceremony today, and it's also my privilege to invite you all to bear witness to this moment. So as they pledge their love to one another and covenant together, I also want to ask you to enter into their joy together this afternoon. Let's pray. Father God, as we begin this wedding ceremony, we want to commit everything that we think and say and do to your glory. The love that Jake and Amy have for one another is a beautiful reflection of the love that they have received from you. And so we want to begin by thanking you for your love. Thank you for bringing these wonderful people together. We ask that you would bless them in this moment, and that we would all see you clearly today in the love that Jake and Amy share. In Jesus' name, amen. This time I'd like to invite Rachel up for a scripture reading.
Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. 1 John 4:7 through 11.
Beautiful, thank you. Well, Jake and Amy, we are here. And here is not necessarily where we expected to be, but we are here. We're here a little few weeks early with friends and extended family watching via live stream in the middle of a global pandemic. I hate to be the one to say it, but I think COVID-19 stole a little bit of your thunder. But at the same time, there's something really appropriate and beautiful about getting married at this time. Right now, our society is consumed with uncertainty and fear and anxiety. Differences of opinion as to what the path forward should look like, when it should happen. And really, this isn't very different from how life is in general, right? The difference of this moment is what we're uncertain about, what we're fearful of, what we have differing opinions on is all the same thing. But most of the time, for us as human beings, life gives us many opportunities each and every day to feel and experience all of those things. They're just not the same for all of us all of the time. So getting married in this moment is in some ways the most appropriate response to COVID-19. So well done. Joining together as man and wife, committed to walking the path set before you as a couple instead of as individuals, makes all the sense in the world. And so as we prepare for you to take your vows and enter into that covenanted relationship, I want to encourage you with these words from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Philippians. These verses are the key to walking the path set before you as a couple, not only in the midst of a pandemic, but in the midst of all the trials and joys, hardships and victories you will face in your lives together. So let's look together at the book of Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Yet let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So the first thing that is apparent in this passage is that Paul clearly, emphatically commands us to rejoice. Right at the beginning of the passage, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. And that sounds good, right? Who doesn't want their life to be marked by rejoicing? After all, if you're rejoicing, that means there's something happening that's making you filled with joy. To rejoice is to find joy or delight in something or someone. It's a response. At the end of the day, we all want our lives to be marked by joyous circumstances and experiences. So far, so good, right? But Paul isn't just recommending a life of joy and fulfillment. Hey, this is a good way to live. Try it out. He's commanding it. This is an imperative. And what's more, there's a clear source that this rejoicing is to be drawn from. Paul instructs us to rejoice in the Lord. The Christian life is not meant to be a life of generic happiness and self-fulfillment. Yes, it's to be a life of joy, but it's to be a specific kind of joy. We are to rejoice in, delight in, find our fulfillment and satisfaction in the Lord. So the question then is why? Obviously, we all want to rejoice, but why should our rejoicing be in the Lord? What does that mean? It means living lives shaped by the gospel. The fact that Jesus, God himself, came to earth and was born as a human baby, lived a sinless life, taught us the way of righteousness, was crucified to pay the penalty for our sins, was raised from the dead and ascended into heaven to prepare a place for us is the reason we rejoice in the Lord. God has made a way for us sinful human beings to be made righteous and holy before him. That is the good news of the gospel that Paul preached in Philippi, and it's the good news that you both have trusted in for the forgiveness of your sins. And it is this gospel that is the reason why we rejoice in the Lord. This precious and great gift that we have been given by God is the source of our hope and joy, regardless of our circumstances. Because we can see next that Paul doesn't just command that we rejoice in God and the gospel when we're feeling it. He commands that we rejoice in the Lord always. Again, he says, rejoice. Why? Because the gospel is always true. No matter what other circumstances you find yourselves in, the gospel is still true. Your greatest need has been fulfilled in Christ. And so you can know that no matter what suffering or struggles you face in this life, your eternal destiny is always secure. And so you can rejoice in the Lord always. And this is so key for you guys in your married life together, because marriage will have ups and downs. You will find joy together, to be sure, but you will also have to face the heartaches and disappointments of life together. And what you have founded not only your individual hope and joy on, but your shared hope and joy will be what carries you through those times. So now, at the beginning of your life together, remember this charge from Paul: rejoice in the Lord always. Next, we see the effect that living a life of joy founded on the gospel has, both for the individual and for you as a couple, namely humility. After rejoicing, Paul tells the Philippians to let their reasonableness be known to all. And this really is the natural result of the gospel. You know this. When we embrace the truth of the gospel, that we're unable to save ourselves, that we're unable to recommend ourselves to God, and that God had to save us, the God we rejected, how can we be arrogant and prideful? And so our joy at being saved by God, Paul encourages us to let that work itself out in humble reasonableness that is on display to all. And again, how appropriate and applicable to your married life. Because while it may be hard to imagine on this beautiful day, life will bring its share of disagreements between the two of you. You will differ in your approach to finances, to parenting, the proper method of loading a dishwasher, you name it. There are some disagreements that you probably can already anticipate from your time together, and there will be plenty that will take you by surprise. In those moments, remembering the truth of the gospel and allowing that to humble and defeat your desire to see your own way win the day will allow you to embrace the rule of love in your life together. As you live your life together, yes, let your reasonableness be known to all, but let it first be known to each other. The next effect of the gospel that Paul outlines for us here is that the gospel drives out fear and anxiety. And it's so beautiful how Paul begins to discuss this topic. At the end of verse 5, Paul writes, "The Lord is at hand." Governing the Christian's whole relationship to fear and anxiety is the truth that because of Jesus, we are never alone. God is with us wherever we are, whatever we are doing, no matter what, forever. And so because of this nearness, Paul tells us to put off fear and anxiety. But the kindness of the Lord is evident in these verses, because notice what we are not given. You're not given just a general instruction, okay, don't be afraid. God doesn't just prescribe a stiff upper lip and move on. No, we're not to be anxious about anything, but rather we are to cast all our fears on the Lord through prayer. The wonderful truth is that because of Jesus, we can enter into the very presence of God through prayer. We're welcomed as sons and daughters. And just like sons and daughters, our Father delights to hear our thoughts and dreams and fears. He doesn't want us to carry our anxieties and fears in our own strength, but invites us to take them and bring them to Him in prayer and to make supplications to Him. He literally asks us to ask Him for things. The application of this to your life and marriage could not be more clear. Do not neglect to pray together. When life seems to loom large over you, when things are unclear or uncertain, when fear or anxiety or doubt are sucking the oxygen out of the room, run to God in prayer together. And for each of you, keep an eye out for one another in this area. This is a primary way you can serve and love each other in your life. In God's kindness, He has given you each other not only to counsel and care for one another, but to pray for one another. Leading one another to the throne of grace is one of the most effective ways you can love one another in moments of fear. Make it a regular practice in your life together. The final thing to glean from these verses is not another command or a means of grace, but it's a promise. What an amazing thing that the God of the universe makes promises to us. What we're promised is that when we find our joy in the gospel, when we embrace humility and surrender our fears to God through prayer, the peace of God, which passes understanding, will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Jake and Amy, this is something that I have been praying for you as you begin your marriage, but most importantly, as you live out your marriage in the years and decades to come. As we've said, this is a strange time that we are living through, and in the midst of it, the hope and faith that people have is being laid bare. For many people, what is being exposed is that they've put their faith and hope in transient things of this world, in jobs, health, retirement accounts, any number of things. And none of these things are bad, but none of them can sustain our hope or our lives. What can sustain your hope and your lives together is the peace that comes with living lives surrendered to God. God promises you that if you rejoice in Him, if you humbly look to serve one another, and you bring your concerns to Him in prayer, He will grant you peace. And not just any peace, but a guardian peace. A peace that isn't based on your circumstances or on what you can perceive or understand, but a peace that is based on the fact that you are children of the Most High God. A peace that is given to you by your Savior. This is my prayer for you, not only today, but for every day that the Lord gives you together, that the peace of God would guard your hearts and minds together in Christ Jesus. So Jake and Amy, as you prepare to take your marriage vows in a moment, I want to charge you to live your life together according to the pattern laid out in this passage. Seek your ultimate joy, not in money, not in children, not even in each other, but first and foremost in the Lord. Then you'll be able to humbly love and enjoy the other good gifts God gives you as a blessing and not as a snare for your heart. Cast your cares and anxieties together on the Lord so that you can live in the peace and comfort that is yours in Christ. May your life together be a shining beacon of the goodness of God. May the love He has poured out in your lives up to this point and that He will continue to pour into your shared life from this day forward overflow from you into the people around you. And may the Lord be glorified in your life together. This time I'd like to invite the family up to pray over the bride and groom as they prepare to take their vows.
Lord, we thank You for Jake and Amy and for their happiness today. And we just thank You for all of the circumstances that You have directed in leading them together. And Father, if we go even back further back in the timeline, we thank You for all of the people and circumstances and influences that have helped shape their personalities and their character and talents and quirks. And Lord, we thank You for that. Those differences we're seeing come together today. And like Ben said, they can be a real blessing when they are blended together in a beautiful way. And so we pray that you would give them harmony as these differences blend together, that they can encourage each other, complement each other, and even challenge each other. But we know that that there are going to be times, there are going to be a lot of times, when those differences create misunderstanding and stress, and they're going to clash. And we know that Satan really wants to capitalize on those times, and he wants to make the most of it and make them last as long as possible. We pray that during those times, Father, that Jake and Amy would throw selfishness far from them. I'm convinced, Lord, that that's one of Satan's main tactics, is selfishness. So we just pray, Father, that you would help them to do that. It's tough sometimes, but your Holy Spirit enables us to do tough things. Most of all, Lord, we thank you for your influence in their lives. And without you in their lives, they wouldn't be the same two people that are here today. We thank you for blessing them with stable families, for helping them, directing them when they needed to make decisions, and guiding them through tough times sometimes. Father, we pray that they would look back often at your blessings and your past faithfulness as they look to you for their future. And then, Lord, as parents today, we are also extremely happy for them. And just as always, we have always wanted the best for them. We want their marriage to flourish, Lord. And so if there are ways in which we can help and encourage them, we pray that that we would be able to do that. Lord, we pray that if there are times when they come to us for advice, that you would give us wisdom, that we would communicate that to them humbly and with diplomacy, representing you and your values and not our own. And for the time, Lord, when we just pray for graciousness and an attitude of understanding for those times when it seems that maybe they just want us to butt out. And we just pray that you would help us then too. Father, we are blessed to be here, and we ask your blessing on Jake and Amy. May their marriage always keep you at the very center. And may all of us do all that we can to lift up the name of Jesus Christ and glorify him in our lives. In his name we pray. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, I echo the words that it's all about you. It's all about Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and rose again. And God, I just am so thankful for each of these two people who are just beautiful people that you created and that you brought together. Thank you for this gift of each of them. Thank you for bringing them together, Father. Thank you for creating this marriage. God, I pray your blessing on this marriage today. I pray that you would bless their ministry, that together they would be ambassadors for Christ far more than they would have been separately. God, I pray that through the good times and the bad times, as has been already said today, that they would understand fully, deep in their hearts, the truth, which is that our hope is in you. Our only hope is in you. And I pray that they would both keep that hope, not just for the near future, but God, forever. This is not a short commitment. Lord God, they are making a commitment before us for all time, until death do them part. And I just pray that 50 years from now, they will still have the same graciousness towards each other that they currently show, the same deep love for each other that overflows to other people around them, the same joy. I just pray that you would be the source of all of that, because we know that you are the only way a person can run the race to the finish. It is through your strength, and it is through your blessing, and it is through your Holy Spirit that you will do these things. And I pray that you will do this in their marriage. Lord, if you bless them with children, I pray that they would rely on you to be the parents that you want them to be. As they grow in areas where they are ministering to other people, again, I pray that they would rely on you. Lord, give them each a deep commitment to each other, an undying commitment that will never be broken, that Satan can never break. When Satan does attack, and we know he will, especially when they're effective for you, we pray that they would keep their eyes on you and realize where these attacks are coming from, and that in so doing, they will be able to make it through the storm and hear your still small voice, I am there with you, and that they would put their trust in you through those times as well. Lord, I am just so overjoyed for this day to gain a daughter and to have my son join together with this woman that you have brought to this point. And I'm overjoyed how you have grown my son over time to become a husband. And I pray that you will continue to grow them both as they learn to live together and to love together and to love you together and to worship you in their marriage. I pray this blessing in the great name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
So Jake and Amy, having freely and prayerfully chosen each other as partners for life, and in an expression of your total commitment to one another, I invite you to please join hands as you prepare to take your vows. Jake, will you have Amy to be your wife, to live together in the covenant of marriage through the faith, hope, love, and power of Jesus Christ, according to the intentions of God for your lives together as a married couple? And Amy, will you have Jake to be your husband, to live together in the covenant of marriage through the faith, hope, love, and power of Jesus Christ, according to the intentions of God for your lives together as a married couple? Now the couple exchange their wedding vows. Jake, please repeat your vows to Amy after me.
I, Jake, take you, Amy, to be my wife.
I, Jake, take you, Amy, to be my wife.
Before God who brought us together.
Before God who brought us together.
To love and cherish you.
To love and cherish you.
Even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her.
Even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her.
To lead you and share all of life's experiences with you.
To lead you and to share all of life's experiences with you.
By following God through them.
By following God through them.
That through his grace we might grow together.
That through his grace we might grow together.
Into the likeness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Into the likeness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Now, Amy, please repeat your vows to Jake after me.
I, Amy, take you, Jake, to be my husband.
I, Amy, take you, Jake, to be my husband.
Before God who brought us together.
Before God who brought us together.
To love you, to cherish you.
To love you, to cherish you.
To submit myself to you in all things.
To submit myself to you in all things.
And to follow you through all of life's experiences.
And to follow you through all of life's experiences.
As you follow God.
As you follow God.
That through his grace we might grow together.
That through his grace we might grow together.
Into the likeness of Jesus Christ, into our Savior and Lord.
Into the likeness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Now Jake and Amy will exchange rings as a symbol and daily reminder of their covenant between each of them and God. Jake and Amy, as high as God is above man, so high are the sanctity, the rights, and the promises of love that you have made to one another. As you exchange these rings as a token of your love, remember that it is not your love that will sustain your marriage, but it is the grace of God to fulfill your marriage vows that will sustain your love. Jake, please repeat after me.
Amy, I give you this ring.
Amy, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love.
As a symbol of my love.
I ask you to wear it.
I ask you to wear it
as a sign to the world,
as a sign to the world,
that you are my wife,
that you are my wife,
as long as we both shall live,
as long as we both shall live.
Amy, please repeat after me. Jake, I give you this ring.
Jake, I give you this ring
as a symbol of my love,
as a symbol of my love.
I ask you to wear it.
I ask you to wear it
as a sign to the world,
as a sign to the world,
that you are my husband,
that you are my husband,
as long as we both shall live,
as long as we both shall live.
Jake and Amy, as you take these vows, may you be blessed by the God before whom you stand. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen. This is a moment of joy and thanksgiving for us all. Having entered here two, you now leave one. And now by the authority committed to me as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is my joy and privilege to pronounce you husband and wife in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jake, you may now kiss your bride. Well, ladies and gentlemen, friends and family, it is my great pleasure to introduce to you for the very first time Mr. and Mrs. Lokkesmoe.
Well, thanks for coming, everybody, and watching this live stream, I guess. Yeah, we're super excited.
We wish you all could have been here in person, but we are really glad for technology, and thanks for joining in, and we just really appreciate all of you and all that you have been to both of us in our lives and now in our life together. So.